And joining us this morning, we're privileged to have with us the new Senate President, Juan Miguel Zubiri. Senate President Zubiri, good morning to you, sir.
Hello, good morning, Karen, and good morning to our kababayans that are listening in today. Good morning, Paul.
Well, I'll start first with congratulating you for becoming the new Senate President. And I'd like to start with this. You know, one would say that there are more senior senators than yourself, and yet you've been voted by a majority of your peers. Why do you think is this so, Senator Miggs?
Well, you know, Karen, I've always said this many times to a lot of close friends. I'm always the groomsman, never the groom. I've been a majority floor leader for three Congresses. It was the 14th Congress, 17th and 18th Congress. Mm-mm. I worked under the likes of Senator Juan Ponce de Leon, my Senate President, together with Senator Tito Soto for two Congresses. As majority floor leader, I've had a good rapport with many of my colleagues. We've had the record-breaking number of bills passed into law. I remember the 14th Congress, we passed over 600 Republic Acts. And also this Congress, or the last Congress rather, we passed about 550 bills on third reading in the Senate, both local and of national application. So I guess it was my track record. And I guess, you know, Karen, kaibigan ko lahat, wala po tayong kaaway, you know, we're very amiable. And I have this ice cream diplomacy. I don't know if it increased the sugar levels of my colleagues, but whenever there's a fight on the floor, I would pause the session and say, let's have some ice cream. You know, we sit down, we talk about our problems, and we come up with a consensus. And I guess it's because I'm a consensus builder and a consultative leader. So I don't dictate upon my colleagues what they should do, what they should not do. I always get the best and the brightest ideas from my colleagues. And so that's what I'm very proud of, Karen.
All right. We'll talk about your vision for the Senate later on. I want to ask you, what was your takeaway? What was your reaction with President Marcos's first State of the Nation address?
Well, it wasn't simply a State of the Nation address, Karen. I think what the press delivered was a plan for a better nation. It was an amazing speech. One speech that touched on so many topics. One thing that I have not heard of in quite a while. And I'm so happy that he touched on so many issues. The environment, climate change, increasing GDP, GDP growth rates. He gave us a macroeconomic lesson in the first 10 minutes. I could see some of my colleagues a bit confused about what he was talking about in the first 10 minutes. But for those like myself who took a lot of economic subjects in UP or in college, we understand what he's trying to push for. He wants to push for a 6.8 to 8% growth rate in the next 4 years, GDP growth rate. And he touched on so many topics that were so vital for the development of the country. It was quite refreshing to hear that. So I was very happy and very pleased about his speech. Most especially when he discussed the specialty hospitals, Karen. You know, I was the one who started the standing ovation. You couldn't see it on TV. But when he talked about the specialty hospitals, bringing in the heart center, kidney center, lung center, cancer center, all over the Philippines, immediately stood up and I clapped because that was my campaign promise to the people in the last elections. And so he got all these best and brightest ideas, and he wants to make it work for the country.
All right. Let's take it one by one. And you're right, he did start off with macroeconomics. In fact, he started off with his medium-term fiscal strategy, or what he called MTFF during the speech. It's quite ambitious, but for many, it was also quite impressive that they felt he was on the ball. He was dictating what he was focused on. So I want to ask you this. A 9% single-digit poverty rate by 2028, or $4,256 in income per capita, and the attainment of an upper middle class. Senator Zubiri, you have sat through many saunas, served many presidents, been elected many times. Do you see this as possible in the next 6 years?
Well, first of all, I'm happy that we have a plan.
Okay.
Because I've sat through a lot of State of the Nation addresses where it's all motherhood statements, not really necessarily having a plan. Mm-mm. He looked at focusing on the economy, how to bring up our GDP growth rate, single-digit poverty rates, how he wants to increase the middle class. And in the beginning, it sounded like great statements, but what were the specifics? Mm-hmm. Then he led into the specifics, which I really appreciate. Mm-hmm. He was talking about healthcare, education, livelihood. He was talking about helping the farmers. Mm-hmm. And he really focused on helping the farmers because he's now the acting Secretary of Agriculture. Mm-hmm. He also acknowledges the challenges ahead. And he gave us the direction.
Yeah.
And even for the legislators, at the very end, he told us, this is what you do.
Yeah.
Many State of the Nations only give, the presidents only give like an overview of what they want from Congress. They'd say, okay, we want to touch on this, we want to touch on that, and we work on it. He gave a 19-point legislative agenda that he wants us to pass. Mm-hmm. How clear is that? That is so clear. Mm-hmm. Clear as day. And that's why, if you notice, me and Speaker Martin, who have great rapport with, and I'm so happy that he's in the helm in the House of Representatives, we kept looking at each other and giving each other fist bumps because we said, okay, this is good that he's laid this out. Mm. Let us tackle this at the soonest possible time.
Yeah.
Can we pass this in the next quarter? And that is great action from the president. It was quite clear and concise.
Uh-oh.
He laid out his plans, for example, in agriculture.
Yeah.
How does he want to help the farmers? He wants to give a moratorium on loan payments.
Yeah.
A lot of the agrarian reform beneficiaries are suffering.
Mm-mm.
Paying
and
land
condonation.
Back.
So I wanted to ask you, the first standing ovation that he received was really when he called on Congress to pass a law that will emancipate the agrarian reform beneficiaries, amending Section 26. So I want to ask you about that. It actually condones all unpaid amortizations and interest. So practically speaking, will that be easy, Senator Zubiri?
If I'm not mistaken, he mentioned the law that we had already passed.
Okay.
That actually allows condonation. We've actually passed that under the Agri-Agra law. I don't know the exact Republic Act, but he mentioned that we already passed the law. I will look into that right away. You know, as majority floor leader, I passed 550 laws or 550 bills last year.
Yeah.
I will find out the exact Republic Act that he mentioned. We're going to review
6657.
There you go.
Okay.
So if that allows the president a leeway to condone loans, then so be it. Let's do it. Because it's a heavy burden on the farmers that they're paying land back, all these fees and loans. And if you have a loan moratorium for 1 year, plus condonation of all the arrears that they have not paid in the past several years, that is a big help to the farmers, a load off their shoulders. And then he continues to discuss how he wants to push for fertilizer, pesticides, and how government will purchase this on their own together with equipment and sell it at cost to the farmers. That is a plan of action for the farmers that I wanted to hear.
Mm-hmm.
And he goes on, you know, I was impressed about this renewable energy agenda.
Okay.
I was impressed how much he talked about climate change. It was so refreshing. It's like the new generation talking, right, Karen? He details digital infrastructure. And, you know, I'm not bothered at all at some sectors saying that he missed a few things in his sauna.
Yeah.
You know, what's important that he was able to cover all the bases. It's impossible to cram all things in one speech unless one expects a telenovela, Karen. You know, initially, according to Secretary Mina of the DBM, when I had a meeting with her, she goes, the president wanted to have a four-hour speech because he said, he wanted to cover so many things.
Yeah.
Of course, many of the experienced cabinet members have told him, sir, you're going to bore the people.
Mm.
So they kind of squished it into 1 hour. According to him, it was a 1 hour.
1 hour, 14 minutes.
When he practiced it, it was about 1 hour, 1 hour. When they practiced it, 1 hour 20 to 1 hour 30.
Yeah.
So they cut it down to about 1 hour 15 now. But he covered most of the bases that we wanted to hear.
Mm-mm.
You know, they're saying, oh, he left out on corruption issues. But weren't they listening? He was talking about ease of doing business.
Yeah.
He mentioned ease of doing business several times in his speech.
Mm.
He mentioned it in energy production.
Mm.
He goes, we have to focus on ease of doing business when it comes to coming up with new power plants, because he sees the bottlenecks there. Ease of doing business is my law. When I was chairman of the Committee on Trade and Industry, we passed that law creating the ARTA, Anti-Red Tape Authority, and strengthening ease of doing business. And that's why he said from 3 months, it should only be 3 weeks lead time to build all these things. So he mentions all of this in his speeches. He discusses the digital infrastructure, but he does not or no longer wants people to line up in government centers to pay or to apply for all these permits. He wants it all online.
So, Senator,
that's the Singapore model.
Yeah. What you're saying is, without having to say zero tolerance for corruption, because it's quite interesting you pointed on that. He had many nuances also in his speech. Is by strength, by focusing on ease of doing business, is a way to eliminate corruption. That's what you're saying.
Yes.
So without having to say the words.
Exactly. I mean, you don't say, oh, we're going to have a strengthened anti-corruption program. He said it in his speech. If you listen carefully, he said that he wanted to plug the tax leakages. Tax leakages, you can lose tax leakages. Tax leakages are through either the inefficiency of tax collection or corruption or both. And he mentioned that in the first part of his speech, how he wants to plug in the tax leakages. And then he discusses about the digital infrastructure, which he mentions many times. And then he mentions ease of doing business twice or thrice in his sauna. Ease of doing business, ladies and gentlemen, is another way of saying strengthen our anti-corruption policies through the ease of doing business. And so he touched on it, and I was quite appreciative of that. And as you said, other things that he was well applauded for was his discussion on education, on health, on tourism. Again, he says ease of doing business in tourism. I recall he was saying that how we can efficiently lay out the road networks, the bridges, the support to the tourism industry to bring back the Filipino brand, not the Filipino brand that people all over the world know about, and so that they can come back in. So it was, for me, it was quite a comprehensive speech. If he said more to the Pinatela novella, I think he wanted to focus on this first. And if I'm not mistaken, Karen, he wants to have another sauna for the stakeholders. I didn't ask him that personally, but I spoke to two secretaries, and he had this idea in Malacanang, in one of the cabinet meetings, that he wants to do another one with a full cabinet slate on stage and discuss it to the different sectors, the foreign chambers, all the industries concerned. And he wants to lay it out one by one on how he plans to do it. So it's quite refreshing, Karen. It's quite refreshing.
Okay, so we'll go on. You mentioned energy a while ago, and energy would be a big difference to the economy. He said that in his speech as well. So I want to ask you, where do you stand when it comes to nuclear? He is the first president to come out. You know, he said we have good environmental laws, but the implementation is the issue. And he said it's time to open our minds and reconsider. In effect, I'm rephrasing, nuclear. He talked about new technologies. And we know how controversial nuclear is, especially with your own colleagues, Senator.
Well, you know, why not? My answer to you is why not? Okay. We are one of the few countries that have not looked at the nuclear option in Southeast Asia. Let me read the list. I just went online just before we came into I came into the show.
Yeah.
The countries that are developing nuclear power in Asia, Indonesia, Thailand, Vietnam, Malaysia, even Singapore is looking at the nuclear option, smaller nuclear power plants.
And they call them modular.
Myanmar is going to develop, imagine a country as small as Myanmar is going to develop nuclear energy. And we're going to be left behind. I mean, I am pro-RE. I'm the author of the Renewable Energy Law. So I'm focused on solar, wind, geothermal, hydropower, even offshore wind projects or programs. I'm for it 100%. But at the end of the day, is it enough to be able to produce the energy requirement that we need in the next 6 years? You want to have 8% GDP growth rate, we better have an energy sector that is robust. that can deliver the power that the different industries need to be able to power all their programs and projects. And I think it's not enough. You know, a nuclear power plant, although it takes about 6 years, Karen, to develop from infancy to the developer to the finished product, but it can deliver 2, 3, 4, 5,000 megawatts in one particular power plant.
Yeah.
And it is renewable because it's infinite. You know, nuclear energy is infinite. It is just how to take care of the nuclear waste problem, how to make sure that the facility is strong enough to, of course, be safe from earthquakes, tsunamis. You know, my wife gave me a said yesterday when he mentioned it, we were watching the news again last night and reviewing the news, and she mentions, yeah, but what happened in Fukushima? And I said, you know, sweetheart, what happened in Fukushima was there was a magnitude 9 on the Richter scale in terms of an earthquake. And of course, they were hit by a huge tsunami after that earthquake. So I said, it's a fortuitous event. It was, I would say, a once in a 100-year catastrophe, calamity. So, and that's why they had the nuclear, leakage or leak. And, and now, it was because of that.
Yes.
But other than that, Japan was running totally, totally nuclear-free accidents for the last several decades. So, if it was built right, built in the proper area, away from any earthquake faults, and he's mentioned again PPP. Yeah. He said government is not going to build; it's going to be private-public partnerships. Yeah. So it's going to you can get with the opening now of the industry under the Public Services Act, you can get a French company to come in and build it. You can get an American or Japanese or Korean company to build and operate.
So clearly you are open to this. You believe it doesn't go against your own advocacies with the environment. And he was referring, just for the record for our viewers, he was referring to modular plants, not the old style of the big nuclear power plants. All right. Thank you very much, Senate President Migzubiri. I wish you well. Good luck to you. And thank you for joining us on Head Start today, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Mabuhay ang Pilipinas, Karen. Mabuhay ang Pilipinas.